Thanks for the introduction. Hello, everyone. So ring signatures are a special type of signature scheme which allow a signer to create a signature in the name of a group of potential signers, which is called the ring. And this signature then also has to be verified with respect to that same ring. And the signature has the nice property that it doesn't reveal who among this group of potential signers actually created the signature, but we can still be sure that they must have been part of the ring. Now, where would you use these kinds of signatures? I have two examples here. The first one is some form of electronic voting, where you would sign your vote in the name of all eligible voters, and by the anonymity property, it would be made sure that no one can tie your vote to your actual identity. The second example I'm giving is in cryptocurrencies, which has picked up a bit more traction recently. In this case, you can use the ring signature to get some form of sender anonymity for your transactions by signing in the name of a set of unspent transaction outputs. As a real-world example, the Monero cryptocurrency uses ring signature for exactly this purpose. Actually, in both of these cases, you would need something a little bit more fancy, which is called linkable ring signatures, but I will, in the first part of the talk, look mainly at plain ring signatures and later describe what this linkability is about. Two observations. Clearly, the larger the size of the group that you sign under, the better your privacy as a signer, in a sort of, at least, so the best you could hope for would be you would think 1 over the size of the ring in terms of can someone guess who signed the signature. And the second observation is we cannot have, in both of these cases, a trusted setup. So it shouldn't be possible that someone who obtains information from this trusted setup can later sort of unveil your vote or track your transactions when you wanted them to be private. So this slide is supposed to give you a short overview of some of the work on ring signatures, excluding schemes in the random oracle model. And what you see here is that if we try to avoid trusted setup, we really had for the longest time signatures that were logarithmic in size in the that were linear in the number of users in the ring. And why do we care about the signature size at all? Obviously, if we can have shorter signatures, we can sign for larger groups. So this increases our privacy, just to get that out of the way. So in this work, for the first time ever, we will present logarithmic size ring signatures without trusted setup, and we can instantiate them entirely from standard assumptions. We also introduce a stronger security model for linkable ring signatures and have an equally logarithmic size construction of a linkable ring signature scheme, also without trusted setup and from standard assumptions. So in the first part of the talk, I will describe our plain ring signature scheme. And for this, I first want to refresh the security notions for ring signatures. So unforgeability intuitively means that no signer can create a signature without having a valid signature without having at least one of the signing keys that belongs to the ring. So we model this as a game where an adversary gets a bunch of honestly generated signing keys, and it can then make signing queries for any of these keys. Notice that this ring may also contain maliciously generated keys by the adversary. It can also ask to corrupt one of these keys, in which case we just provide the randomness that was used to generate the key to the adversary. And in the end, the adversary will output a forgery attempt, and we say this forgery is valid if the signature, the ring signature, is valid, none of the keys in the forgery ring were corrupted, and the signature also didn't come out of the signing oracle. Okay, and anonymity is a quite strong property, since it's such a basic requirement. For this, we intuitively want that not even a person that has somehow gained access to all the randomness that was used to generate the keys in the ring should be able to tell who created a particular signature with that ring. So we model this by not only giving the public keys, but also immediately all of the randomness that was used to generate them. Now the adversary will give us two challenge indices, a message and a ring, which contains these public keys indicated by the indices, and we will create, depending on the bit we chose, a ring signature under one of these challenge signing keys. Again, this ring might contain maliciously generated verification keys. And now the adversary obviously has to check or has to guess which key we use to create this ring signature. If that's not possible without chance non-negligibly better than guessing, then we say the scheme is anonymous with respect to against full key exposure. All right, these are the formal notions for security. Now we can start looking at our scheme, and I will build up to our scheme through a series of constructions. And this first one is basically a sign encrypt proof construction. So we need a digital signature scheme, a public key encryption scheme, and a perfectly sound non-interactive witness indistinguishable proof. Notice that we do not use a NISIC because we want to avoid the trusted setup, and this is why we have to use the NIVI proofs. So in our scheme, the verification keys or the public keys in the ring are composed of a signature verification key and an encryption key for the signature scheme and the public key encryption scheme, and the signing keys are just the corresponding secret keys. So let's say we have a ring of size 4, as I will keep it for the rest of the talk for example's sake, and we hold the signing key for this third verification key. To create a signature, we now sign with our signing key the message, and we encrypt the message under our public key, and we also encrypt for every other public key in the ring a dummy value that is just an encryption of 0 under the respective public key. Now we now comes the proof part. So we have to show using our NIVI proof the following statement, namely that one of these ciphertexts contains a valid signature under the respective signing key. And the final signature is then just this array of ciphertexts and the proof pi. It should be immediately clear that this signature, although it is without trusted setup, is of linear size because of this array of ciphertexts. I will now show you how we prove unforgeability and anonymity for this scheme, because the basic idea will stay the same for the other constructions as well, with some minor complications, but just so you get an idea for the final scheme. First, unforgeability. As I said, the NIVI proof is perfectly sound. So if the adversary manages to forge, we know that one of the ciphertexts must contain a valid signature under some verification key. So if we can set up the reduction in such a way that it knows all the decryption keys, we can just decrypt all the ciphertext and check which one contains the signature, which will then be a forgery for the underlying signature scheme, since all the keys in the ring must be honest. So this is unforgeability. Anonymity works by moving from one challenge key to another. And let's say we have these two keys selected as the challenge keys, and we start with the third key as our starting point. So in this case, the signature we encrypt is in this third ciphertext, and is the signature valid under the third signing key. For the proof, we then use this witness composed of the signature and the randomness for the ciphertext. In the first step, because of the in-CPA security of our encryption scheme, we will replace this the ciphertext corresponding to the other challenge key with a real encryption of a signature under that key. And now we can, because of witness indistinguishability, swap the witness for this other ciphertext. And again, we can, because of the in-CPA security, just replace this previously correctly generated signature by the dummy value. And now we have moved from one challenge key to the other challenge key. And this proves anonymity. Okay, that's just the basic idea. Now, the first problem that we want to address is the number of ciphertexts in the in the witness. So how do we do this? Crucially, we noticed that in our proof, we only really needed two ciphertexts, namely one to encrypt our real signature and the other one so we can do this swapping. So what we do is we take a slightly different encryption scheme, which has pseudorandom ciphertexts and public keys, which is really nothing special, but we need this. And we encrypt our signature as before under our own key. And for all the other keys in the ring, we will now just take one ciphertext, which we choose uniformly at random. Why can we do this? Well, this ciphertext shouldn't be associated with any particular key in the rest of the ring. And later we will use the special properties of this encryption scheme to make sure that the adversary doesn't notice when we mess with this ciphertext. The statement we prove has to reflect this somehow. So now we have these two ciphertexts, and we sort of build a big OR proof that either or yeah, one of these ciphertexts contains a valid signature under a public key in the ring. The final signature now is a bit compressed. We have only these two ciphertexts and the proof. But if you paid close attention also before, actually this statement in the proof is also linear in the size of the members of the ring. So this proof will be linear as well. So we are not quite finished with the construction yet. And it would be nice if we could replace this proof with a kind of standard membership proof as we use in other places. So we would like to have a statement that says, okay, one of these ciphertexts contains a valid signature under a key, and this key is in the ring proven by some small membership proof. The standard candidate for such membership proofs would be a Merkle tree. Yeah, so we will build a Merkle tree over our ring, and to build the witness or prove the statement, we just collect, you can't see it really well, but we collect the necessary elements to build this path in the tree to our key. And the new statement just reflects this, what I just said. So one of the ciphertexts contains a valid signature under some key that is included in the ring by this membership proof. All right, so now we have a logarithmic statement because of the membership proof. Ciphertexts are independent of the length, so it seems we are done, right? Well, unfortunately not, because as I showed you before, the unforgeability proof crucially relied on the fact that the Newey proof was perfectly sound. So we could know if the ring was honest, that at least one of these ciphertexts contained a valid signature under a key in the ring. This Merkle tree, however, is actually only computationally sound, and especially if we want to avoid trusted setup, we would have to allow the signer to choose the hashing key, and in this way the signer could easily choose a bad hashing key that allows them to prove something about a key that is not actually in the ring. So this approach does not work if we want to avoid trusted setup. Instead, what we can do, or what we have to find, is a way to give this membership proof, but we really only want the perfect binding of this proof to be valid at this one specific point in our ring. And for this, we use a recently described primitive called somewhere perfectly binding hashing, which amazingly allows us to do exactly what we want. So it's a type of hashing where you can generate the key for hashing a database of a given size, and additionally specify some index into this database where our key will be perfectly binding. So now we can use this key to hash our database into a succinct digest, and later we can also provide a opening witness. So this is like a statement that, or a short witness that says, hey, in this database that I will hash with this hashing key HK at the specific index, we have value X. And later, this opening witness can be verified publicly using just the digest and not providing the actual database. So this has the following properties. It's perfectly binding at this one index. And the hashing key also hides computationally the exact index at which it is perfectly binding. And luckily for us, all these entities that will be relevant for us, namely the hashing key, the digest, this witness, and even the circuit for verifying the witness, are of log size in the database, which will be our ring eventually. So to put it all together, our log size ring signature scheme works as follows. So we have the ciphertext as we did before. And now we, for every time we want to sign a signature, we generate two hashing keys, which we specify to be binding at the exact position of our own key. Now we create the two digests. And for one of the digests, we compute this opening. And what we do now is we basically give a proof that for this hashing key, this digest, some index I, and we have in the database that corresponds to the digest verification key such that one of the ciphertexts contains a valid signature under that key. The actual statement is like a composition of two of these kinds of statements because we are generating a second hashing key and we'll use this to swap the witness later, but I've shown it here like this for simplicity. So in the final signature, we have the two ciphertexts, the two hashing keys, and the proof, which is now of logarithmic size because of the logarithmic size of the verification circuit of this SPB hash. And crucially, notice that we can allow the signer to choose this hashing key themselves because they are perfectly binding, so there's no way even maliciously to choose them in a way such that they are not binding at this particular index. So to verify the signature, you recompute the two digests using these hashing keys and then try to verify the proof. Okay, so this is our scheme. How can we instantiate it? So the signature scheme and the public key encryption, we can use any number of standard schemes that we know of. The SPB hash, we have an instantiation from DDH and one from DCR. And for the NIWI proof, we can use, for instance, the Groth-Ostrowski-Sahai proof. And regarding the size, I already said it, all the properties are, all the components of the SPB hash that we need are of logarithmic size in the database, respectively the ring. And this verification circuit for our signatures is also, for our statement is also of logarithmic size. So the overall size of our signatures is logarithmic in the number of users in the ring. Okay, so that was our first construction of plain ring signatures. Now I will talk a little bit about the linkability aspect. So what are linkable ring signatures? They provide an additional functionality, namely you can publicly check whether two signatures were actually created by the same signer. So the idea is that you can use this in these applications, for instance, to detect multiple votes by the same voter or like double spending attempts, things like that. It should be clear that we cannot give the same anonymity guarantees as before, since it was a very strong notion where we gave the adversary all the randomness and so forth, because now the adversary could just use this public linking algorithm to check for the challenge signature, whether it links to any previously seen signature of the challenge users. In previous models, this was usually solved in the following way, that you just didn't give the adversary access to any signing oracle. So if there's nothing to use link on with your challenge signature, you obviously can't use link to check what user created the challenge signature. We think that we have a slightly stronger notion. I will describe it in a minute. First, I'll just show you the other two notions that we need, which is this linkability property that says if you have L signing keys, you shouldn't be able to create L plus one pairwise unlinkable signatures. So you can't create more unlinkable signatures than you have actually different signing keys. The non-frameability is a complementary property that says the adversary can't maliciously create a signature that links to an honest user's signature. These are important, but the main part of our new model, I think, is the linkable anonymity property, which I'll describe now. So I said before that we can't quite get the strong anonymity as before. So instead of giving the randomness, we can, in the first step, only provide all the verification keys. And then we expect the adversary to give us sort of two challenge indices. And for all of these keys, except for the two challenge indices, we will give the adversary the randomness. So there are two like blind spots for the adversary here. Then the adversary can ask for signatures under any kinds of keys and rings, and we will answer them differently depending on exactly what is contained in the query. Namely, if either one of the challenge keys is in this ring that the adversary provided, then the other one must be in the ring as well. Otherwise, you could imagine a simple attack where you can create a ring with either only one of the keys and a ring with only the other key, and then try to build a simple linking attack as before. So if the challenge keys are in the ring, they must be both in the ring or none at all. If the key that the adversary requests the signature on is one of the challenge keys, then depending on our bit, we will sign using one of those keys. So basically, in the end, the adversary has to output a guess as to which permutation of the challenge keys we found or we gave him. So this is kind of similar to the blindness property of blind signatures. And crucially, note that the adversary can obtain, even though there's this linking algorithm, can obtain signatures from both challenge signing keys, which makes it stronger than these previous models. Okay, that's our linkable anonymity notion. We also have in our paper a linkable ring signature scheme, which has the same characteristics as our plain ring signature scheme, so logarithmic size, standard model, no setup. And I'll briefly describe the general idea. So we include in our signatures some kind of tag, and in the public keys we have a commitment to this tag, and we now want to show that in the signature we can decommit or prove the correctness of this commitment to the tag. The problem is that, as I said, the adversary gets to see both proofs, basically, so we cannot use the hiding property of the commitment to show anonymity. And our idea how we solve this is that we sort of create a kind of malleable commitment, which are malleable in a very specific way and allow us to mess with the ring bit by bit to change the positions of the challenge keys in the ring. The full details you can find in the paper, or you can ask me later. So to sum up, I'm running out of time, and I have shown you our logarithmic size ring signatures from standard assumptions without any trusted setup. I have described our new model for linkable ring signatures, and in our paper you can find the full details and all the proofs in the full version at ePrint for also the linkable ring signature scheme. All right, so I'd be happy to take questions. Thanks.
So for questions, the mics are there, but if you're in the front, I will happily give you a microphone, and otherwise you might have to repeat the questions.
I'm a bit worried about the notion of linkable ring signatures because it opposes, in some sense, the motivation for the original ring signature. In our original paper, we were thinking about a situation where n minus 1 out of the n are unhappy with the fact that they are in the ring, and this gives them a way how to prove that they were not the source of the leaked secret. Similarly, in a voting situation, it's true that you will be able to prevent double voting, but it will enable anyone to prove convincingly that he didn't participate in the voting. And I can think about situations in which he will be paid $10 for not participating in some vote. And now he has a perfect way how to prove it.
Yeah.
So Isn't there a contradiction between the linkability requirement and the ring signature idea?
Yes, certainly. For the, I mean, yes, I didn't mention it in this talk, but as you said, the original motivation you put forth was like this whistleblowing scenario. Yeah. And in this case, you really wouldn't want to use a linkable ring signatures. The linkability obviously contradicts this anonymity and also allows other people to prove that they are not the source of some kind of information. So in this case, you would just use a plain ring signature scheme.
So sort of the same question. I guess the linkability, so you mentioned it for cryptocurrency applications. I guess the linkability would also be, well, maybe it doesn't even make any sense for accounts, but it seems like it only makes sense for UTXO model. If you had a ring VRF, you could probably do other things that might go sort of get in between, be useful for more cases.
Oh, okay, thanks. Yeah, I didn't think about this.